If you would take your Bibles to Mark chapter 13 this morning. Hopefully I didn't just ruin your day by saying that the worst days are yet to come. The worst days that our world will ever see are on the way, and we're going to start to look at some of those end time events. We obviously won't talk about all of what Jesus has to say regarding end times this morning. So Mark chapter 13, let's start reading in verse 1, and we'll go ahead and read down through verse 13. We'll probably spend most of our time on verses 1 through 8 this morning, but we'll go ahead and read down through verse 13. We could read the whole chapter, but we won't for sake of time this morning. So Mark 13, again, this is still on Tuesday, the of the week that Jesus was crucified, the Passion Week. So he's been in the temple teaching, answering questions, asking questions, and now we see him leaving the temple at the end of Tuesday, and that's where we pick up Mark 13, verse 1. And as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here, referring to the temple. And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew, by the way, we're not going to spend much time on this, but that's the only time that you see the inner three stretched out to include four. These four, kind of an inner circle, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, asked him privately, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus answering them began to say, Take heed, lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled. For such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in divers places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in the synagogues ye shall be beaten, and ye shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them. And the gospel must first be published among all nations. But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do ye premeditate. But whatsoever shall be given you in that hour, that speak ye, for it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost. Now the brother shall betray the brother to death, and the father the son, and children shall rise up against their parents, and shall cause them to be put to death. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. This passage is given from, it identifies it there in verse 3, that as Jesus sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, it's given from the Mount of Olives. By the way, when it says over against the temple, he's not right beside the temple. There, they've gone down and then back up. There's an elevated spot called the Mount of Olives, and it looks over the Kidron Valley, and then you can see Jerusalem. You could see the temple from there. It was quite a sight from what people say. Nowadays, you can look over and see the Muslim mosque, the Dome of the Rock. But at that time, the temple was there in all of its gleaming and shining glory. The entire temple was overlaid with gold, and the sun would reflect off of it. You could, if the sun hit it just right, you couldn't even look at it. It was so bright and shining, they'd say you'd have to look away. And when people would travel to Jerusalem, that was the landmark that would stand out. And so as they are leaving the temple, this impressive structure that, by the way, King Herod was, this is what we often call Herod's temple. It was the one that was standing during the time of Jesus' day. It had taken 46 years to build to that point and was not even finished. He was going to build it for a couple more decades of building. And then almost soon after it was finished, it was destroyed. Great shame. But it was, even though it was not totally finished, it was very impressive. the superstructure, the amount of acreage that it took up. Some estimate that it took up one-third of the land area, the whole temple complex, one-third of the land area of the old city of Jerusalem there. It was just a huge, sprawling complex. And so the disciples, let me just mention this first before we get what the disciples mentioned to him. This passage is often called the Olivet Discourse that we've read this morning, part of what we've read. And it's also recorded in Matthew 24 and 25 and Luke chapter 21, three places where the Olivet Discourse, it's a wonderful, we're looking forward to walking through it. We'll look mostly in Mark, but we'll compare and contrast some things in Matthew and Luke as well to help fill in some of the details. But the Mount of Olives was a special place to Jesus. He would often go there with the disciples. He went there on the night that he was betrayed to pray. It was the spot where he left at the time of the ascension. It was from the Mount of Olives. It was his launching pad. It is also where he will return, the Mount of Olives. And so he gives this address here in a special place to his heart, the Mount of Olives. And as they're leaving the temple on this Tuesday, one of the disciples remarks to Jesus, "Jesus, let's just pause here. Take a look around us behind us. Look how awesome this temple is. Look at what manner of buildings. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it astonishing?" And Jesus doesn't really seem to be that impressed, does he? He says, "Oh yeah, it's great. It's all going to be destroyed." That's all he has to say. And by the way, this was fulfilled, what he says here. There's not going to be one stone left upon another. When General Titus came with the Roman army in AD 70, the original plan was not to destroy the temple. In fact, he was given specific instructions from the emperor not to destroy the temple. But in the mayhem along the way, somebody set a fire and things caught on fire. By the way, the fire was so hot there at the temple as things were burning that the gold around the temple began to melt and to ooze, and all of the Roman soldiers, probably others as well, but the Roman soldiers went after that, and they pulled all of the gold out of the temple, including pulling the stones away so they could get at the gold in between. That was the cause of why there was not one stone left on another. It was basically a big looting of the temple. And even though that was not the original intent, as Jerusalem was sacked, as the city was destroyed, the temple, and then later on, they closed off the entire city. Nobody could go out. Nobody could come in. They starved the city to death. Many people starved in the city. Those that would escape and go out to try to get some kind of nourishment or help or something, they were captured and they were crucified outside of the city. There were just dozens and hundreds of crosses where people were crucified outside of the city. And they were all destroyed. The city was destroyed. The temple was destroyed. The people were destroyed. And Jesus is very clear. We won't turn to passages right now. But Jesus is very clear that all of that happened simply because Israel rejected Jesus when he came. They knew not the time of their visitation, when their Messiah was offered to them. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. And because of that was this prophecy given, that not one stone would be left on another. But so Jesus was not really that impressed. Jesus didn't say, "Yeah, you know, it's gonna be destroyed, and it's such a shame because it's so awesome. I wish we could preserve this forever." You know, God is not impressed with the physical accomplishments of man. Have you figured that out in your life yet? We often go back and forth. We struggle with the concept. It's very easy to be enamored with all that glitters in the world, isn't it? It's very easy to look at houses and cars and yachts and nations and what they can accomplish and mankind, what he can do, and be impressed with it. But God's not impressed. God gave man the ability to do everything he can do, and he knows what he's capable of doing, and that's not what impresses God. You know what impresses Jesus is faith. When somebody believes in him, that's what makes Jesus take a step back and say, "Wow, everybody come gather around, look at this." Remember when he showed the widow who gave her two mites? Jesus was more impressed, same day by the way, he was more impressed with a widow giving two mites, which are next to nothing, because she demonstrates her faith in God. He was more pleased and impressed with that than with the 50 years of building the temple and all that went into it, all the gold and all the pomp and all the extravagance. He's more impressed with our faith. Let me just read a couple of verses very quickly. And in fact, let's go ahead and turn to this one, Matthew chapter 8 And we'll look at verses 8 through 10. While you're turning there, I'll read a verse in Matthew 15. Two other places where we see that what gets Jesus' attention is faith. And what we ought to strive for is not what the world thinks is valuable, but what Jesus thinks is valuable. So look at Matthew 15, 28. Matthew 8. I'll read Matthew 15, 28. It says, "Then Jesus answered and said unto her," this is a woman who is kind of having a conversation back and forth with Jesus, "come and heal my daughter." And he says, "Well, you're a Gentile. We didn't come to, but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." And she says, "Truth, Lord, but even the dogs get to eat the crumbs that which fall from the master's table." And she says, "I'm willing to be a dog. I just want anything. Will you help me?" And he says, "O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt." And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. What grabbed onto his attention, what grabbed onto his power was faith. And look at Matthew 8 and verse 8. This is when a centurion comes to Jesus and asks for help. For sake of time, we're not going to look at the whole story, but just verses 8 through 10. It says, "The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it." When Jesus heard it, he marveled. He took a step back and he said, "Wow." This is quite a statement, that the God of the whole universe marvels and is astonished at something. And what he says about it is his faith. And when Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to them that followed, "Verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel." And so Jesus was not impressed on that day. He never said wow to the buildings of the temple. But what makes Jesus say wow is a simple, childlike, humble faith. And how's our faith today? It's not really the point of our message, but just wanted to, as an aside, look at that. The disciples here, they ask Jesus for a sign. He says, the temple's going to be destroyed, not one stone left on another. And then when they get over to the Mount of Olives, they ask him, what is the sign about all this? When is this going to happen? And what is the sign that will happen when all of these things will be fulfilled? And Jesus answered their question, by the way. They ask for a sign, and he gives them a sign. Not all the time in the Bible. Remember when the Pharisees and the scribes, the scoffers, come to Jesus and say, show us a sign from heaven that you're who you say you are. And he said to them, there shall no sign be given to this generation, but the sign of the prophet Jonah, and so forth. So Jesus didn't always answer people's requests for a sign, but he did answer the disciples' question. They're not asking, there is in a scoffing type of way. But Jesus, he gives several signs here in this chapter about what would happen preceding and leading up to and even concurrent with the end times. So what they what they're asking for, and by the way, look at a passage in Matthew 24. Let's see what Mark doesn't include a couple of the details of their question. Jesus doesn't say anything about the end of the world. All he says is the temple is going to be destroyed. And they ask a very interesting question regarding his statement. Matthew 24, this is the sister passage in verse 3. It says, "And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be?" So that's the destruction of the temple that Jesus, these things. "And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" Seems like quite a jump that they make. The temple's going to be destroyed, not one stone left on another. And they say, wow, when's this going to happen? Tell us about the sign of your coming and the end of the world. End of the world, he's just talking about AD 70, the destruction of the temple. But to the Jewish mind, the destruction of the temple was a big deal. It was like the end of the world. So they literally thought that for the temple to be destroyed, it must be something like this, something like you're coming back, your second coming, the end of the world. And so they ask, really what they're asking is two separate questions, but they think they're asking one question. When's all this going to happen? Really, it ends up being two questions, and Jesus answers that. As we walk through Mark 13, and you compare also with Matthew and Luke, it's at times difficult to pinpoint when he is answering one question and when he's answering the other question. The answers kind of can blend together. We'll try to separate some of that a little bit as we walk through it. But, you know, many people today are looking for a sign. Even people with the Bible, even people that believe the Bible, they're living their lives watching the news, waiting for the next fulfillment of prophecy, waiting for the next sign to say, okay, now we can get ready. Now Jesus is going to come back. Now the end of the world, the end time events are rolling. And look at an interesting passage before we continue on, just as one more aside this morning. Titus 2 and verse 11. Here's what God says we should be looking for today as Christians. We shouldn't be, and by the way, we may see some things happen that look like they're shaping up toward things that will be true in the end times during our lifetime. But we shouldn't be preoccupied with looking for signs, things that happen in the world today. Here's what the Bible says we should be looking for. Titus 2 and verse 11. It says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ." Jesus says what we should be, or God says here in Titus 2, what we should be looking for day by day is our blessed hope. We shouldn't be looking for bad things to happen in the world. What we should be expecting and watching and waiting for is Jesus coming to get us. The glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what we should be looking for today. So let's go ahead and walk through this passage. Jesus gives them eight signs here in Mark 13. I'm going to go ahead and list all eight that go through this chapter. We're going to spend our time on the first three this morning, but let me go ahead and just mention all eight with the corresponding references in Mark 13. Jesus answered the question, what's a sign of when these things will be when these things shall be fulfilled and the end of the age? Number one, Mark 13, verses 5 and 6, Jesus says that there's going to be religious deception. The first sign of the end times is that there's going to be religious deception. We'll come back to these. Number two, there's going to be wars and rumors of wars in Mark 13, verses 7 and 8, first part of verse 8. Wars and rumors of wars. Number three, there are going to be earthquakes and famines and troubles. And that's Mark 13 and verse 8. That's as far as we'll get this morning, those three. We'll go on in the future weeks. Number four, there will be religious persecution. Mark 13, verses 9 through 13. Religious persecution. Number five, there will be the abomination of desolations, the phrase that it uses here. And this basically goes from Mark 13, 14 all the way down through verse 23. This is an event that will be, we'll spend more time on this, and we'll spend more time on him. This is an event that will be carried out by what's often called the Antichrist, the man of sin, the man of perdition. Daniel chapter 9, we'll go back and look at that passage. It talks about it. That when the abomination of desolation happens, that marks the midpoint of the tribulation, the separation between the tribulation and the great tribulation. The first 3.5 years, the second 3.5 years, the Antichrist will have a 7-year peace treaty with Israel and with the entire world, and then he will break that peace treaty. Daniel 9 explains it. He will break that peace treaty halfway through. He'll go into the temple and commit an act where he'll declare himself to be God. This is, and he'll demand to be worshipped by everyone. He'll begin to persecute Israel. And so that's the abomination of desolation. We'll talk more about that. Then number six, the sixth sign, I'm not going to say that five times fast. Number six is that the heavenly bodies are altered. The sun will be darkened, the moon turned into blood, the stars will fall from heaven, there will be a great shaking, and that's Mark 13, verses 24 and 25. And then number seven is when Jesus appears in Mark 13 and verse 26. That Jesus will be from heaven, he will appear. And then number eight, Mark 13, 27, will be the gathering together of the elect. And so we'll get into those in the coming couple of Sundays. So eight signs that Jesus gives to answer their question. He gives a very detailed, he gives more detail than they were expecting on that day. He starts talking, they're like, wow. And as he keeps talking, they're like, man, I need a piece of paper to write this down. Don't worry, the Holy Spirit filled it all in all the details later as they record this. So let's back up and look at these three first three signs that the end times will be coming. By the way, I will say this, that some of them we can see bits and pieces of or manifestations of all the way through the church age. And then some of them, all of these will get increasingly more frequent, increasingly worse as you get closer. They will be even worse during the first 3 years of the tribulation, and then they will be even worse and horrible during the great tribulation. So some of these we can see even now in our day. The first three that we'll look at this morning, we can even see today, but there will be an uptick in all of these going forward. So number one sign that the end is coming is religious deception. Look at Mark 13 and verse 5. Religious deception. And Jesus answering them began to say, "Take heed, lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many." And by the way, if you have King James Version, you notice there that the word Christ is in italics, which means it's not in the Greek, and it was added for clarity and being able to see exactly what they're talking about. But literally, they will come in Jesus' name saying, I am. They'll claim to be God. There will be many people that claim... By the way, I like that... it's a neat little verse, neat little point about the deity of Christ. When they say, I am Christ, or if they say, I am, meaning I am God, they're claiming to be the same thing, because Christ is God. Neat little place for the deity of Christ there. But many throughout history have, and many in the future will, and many during the first 3 years of the tribulation, first 3.5 years, and the Antichrist will be the ultimate fulfillment of this. He will say that I am Jesus. By the way, the word Antichrist, and we're not going to spend much time talking about him today, but the Greek phrase, the Greek prefix anti, means one of two things, or maybe even both. It means against. If you're anti something, you're against. He's against Jesus. But it also means instead of. The prefix anti can mean in the place of it. And the Antichrist will be against Jesus, but he will also claim to be Jesus. He will claim to be the replacement, you know, the false substitute, the counterfeit, and so forth. So there will be great religious deception. Matthew 24:11 says, "And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many." Many people will be deceived. In fact, it's going to be so much deception. Second Thessalonians, we're not going to turn there today, we'll look at it later. But 2 Thessalonians 2 says that God is going to send the world strong delusion, that they might believe the lie. People are going to believe that other people are God, that there's no way that these people would typically believe. There's no way they would fall for this. But God is going to send supernatural strong delusion. He's going to allow people to be deceived. There's going to be great deception in the end times, and we already see that even today. Let's look at a couple of passages. Now look at 2 Peter chapter 2, and then we'll look at a verse in Jude that show that there's been a warning, there's been a need to watch out for this all the way back to the first century. It continues today. We are surrounded. I couldn't pick a number this morning about the number of false teachings there are. It seems like every day some new cult can arise. Hey, I've started a new religion. And people go after it. People are very fickle. People follow religions like, you know, Facebook and Twitter, and you can call a lot of things a religion. I'm not saying those are, but they can be. But there are so many false teachings. There's so many people saying, I've got a new way to God. I've got a new way to heaven. No, there's not even heaven. We'll call it nirvana. We'll call it this and that. And they're everywhere. There are cults. They abound. And as Christians, we need to watch out, because Christians who are saved on their way to heaven and who believe the Bible can get to the place where they're sucked away by things. I've heard this statistic before, that among the Mormons, their greatest pool from which they get converts is Baptists. That so many people, it seems so similar. They say they're Christian. I mean, they're family-oriented. They're even smiling. I mean, they're so nice. How can they not be right? And if you don't know the Bible, we can be led astray. These are great warnings to know the truth of the Bible. Look at 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 1. It says, "But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you." So this is written 2,000 years ago. "There shall be false teachers among you who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. And all throughout the rest of that chapter, really the entire chapter of 2 Peter 2, is devoted to false teachers, watching out for false teachers, watching out for false teaching. Why is there a warning? Because we can be led astray. If it were impossible for a Christian to be led astray, you wouldn't even put that warning in the Bible. We don't need it. But we need the warning to watch out for it. It says they will privily bring in these damnable heresies. When false teachers come into a church, they do it secretly. They don't come in and say, "Hey, welcome. I'm good to be here today. I want to let you all know that I'm a false teacher. I'll be setting up a class if you guys like to come and learn some of my heresy. If you follow what I'm doing, we're on the way to hell. Come and we'll start next week." They don't do that. They come in and Jesus says they'll come in my name. They will claim to be Christians. They will claim to be for God. And that's the way that the devil does it. You know, if you can't beat them, join them. And the devil tries to join churches and tries to join group bodies of believers and to derail them. He can't get their souls, but he can still derail people and make them spiritually ineffective by having them believe error. Look at Jude and verse 4. We'll just look again, all of Jude, the primary theme of Jude is to watch out for these. There's a lot of overlap, very, very many similarities between 2 Peter 2 and Jude. The reason is they were written by the same person, by God. So Jude, look at verse 4. It says, "For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness." That, what does that mean? The grace of God means that God gives a free gift. Lasciviousness means live however you want. Some people are saying, yeah, you can go to heaven by not doing anything. In fact, just live it up, do whatever you want. God never intended that. We just read earlier where the grace of God teaches us to deny ourselves, to deny ungodliness and worldliness. The grace of God does not teach us to live a lascivious lifestyle. But that's one of the marks of false teachers. They'll tell you, yeah, it doesn't matter how you live, do anything. You're saved, you're going to heaven. And God does not teach that at all. So finish out that passage. It says, "Turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." So they deny the truths of God. They deny Jesus himself. By the way, if that word lasciviousness is confusing, it's pretty similar to concupiscence. So it's the way that I like to remember it. Okay, that's number one. The first sign of the end times is there will be religious deception. There has been for 2,000 years. There continues to be today, and there will continue to be. And then it will get more and more. There will be an uptick as we get toward the end times. So just because you see religious deception doesn't mean, look at that, there's a religious false teacher. Jesus is coming back tomorrow. The world, the tribulation is going to begin tomorrow. We can't necessarily say that, but it is a sign that we're going that direction. Number two, the second thing that Jesus mentions is that there will be wars and rumors of wars. So Mark 13, look at verse 7. Mark 13 and verse 7, it says, "And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled." Don't be moved. Don't say, "Oh no, this is awful. It's the worst thing ever. We need to run away. We need to do something." It says, "Don't be troubled, for such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom." This is one of the things that we could say about all of human history as well. Wars and rumors of wars. There have always been wars. Sometimes you just go into a house and there's wars there. Why? Because you have fallen people living together. I know that's true. Some households, there are fallen people living together under the same roof. It's all of our households. We all have wars to some extent. And there are nations that fight against each other. And it's often been said that the history of man has been written in blood, that there's bloodshed and war and fighting everywhere you turn. There always has been. I know that World War I was at the time called the war to end all wars, but it wasn't. There's been wars since then. there will never be world peace. Even though, you know, all of the Miss America and the Miss Universe contestants, even though they want world peace, it's not going to come before the Prince of Peace comes. Jesus is the one who will make world peace once and for all. But until then, our world will be partly defined by wars and rumors of wars. And now they will get worse. Sometimes you look at a certain war that happens, and like World War II is so awful, so many millions of people that die, and you say, how can it get worse? But it can, and it will. Look at a passage in Revelation chapter 6. By the way, there's a great parallel between the signs that Jesus gives here in Mark 13 in the Olivet Discourse and the seal judgments as they are unfolded in Revelation chapter 6. And we're going to go ahead and read several verses here, and you'll see the flow that it includes a lot of the details that Jesus mentions that we've already seen in Mark chapter 13. So I want to read verses 1 all the way down to verse 14. I want to read all this just to see that flow and a lot of the parallels and overlaps, but part of it we'll see the war that's going to be involved during the tribulation period. Revelation 6 all happens during the tribulation period. There's going to be an uptick of war, and there will be much war and much bloodshed and famine and so forth, pestilence during the tribulation period. So Revelation 6, let's start reading verse 1. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast saying, and by the way, if you the seals we're talking about, they're not, the seals that hold balls on their noses. We're not talking about the animal. We're talking about a seal that when you roll up a scroll, roll up a document, and they would put wax, and then a king would put his stamp, put his seal. And what's happening here is that Jesus is breaking the seals and opening the title deed to the earth, showing his sovereignty and his ownership. So that's the seal judgments as Jesus opens all of these. Verse 3, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, "Come and see." And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. So there's war and bloodshed there in the second seal. Verse 5, and when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, "Come and see." And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, "A measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. And see thou hurt not the oil and the wine." So there's great famine, and the economic system's turned upside down. Verse 7, and when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, "Come and see." And I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. So during that seal, that fourth seal, you've got one-fourth of the world's population killed in a short period of time. If there are 8 billion, to pick a number, if there are 8 billion people on earth at that moment, 2 billion will be killed in a short period of time just in that fourth seal. Look at verse 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. So there you see religious persecution. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. Number 3 we'll talk about in Mark 13 is the earthquakes. And there are, we'll talk about earthquakes in a minute. Look at verse 12. And lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together. And every mountain and island were moved out of their places. So you see all the different cataclysmic events. Some of them are man-made. Some of them involve men fighting with each other. Some of them involve the natural elements that God reaches down and shakes the earth. But you see a great parallel between a lot that goes on in the sealed judgments and then the signs that are coming that Jesus mentions in Mark 13. So the second one that he mentions there is that there will be wars and rumors of wars. There always have been, there will be, but they will get increasingly worse. And then number three we get to is in Mark 13, verse 8, is earthquakes. Earthquakes, famines, and troubles. Often you see famine follow an earthquake. Often you see an earthquake do a lot of damage, and then you've got a lot of hunger and displacement follow. So Mark 13, verse 8 says this, "For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in diverse places." They're going to be everywhere. "And there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows." I was recently just looking at some earthquake statistics, and last year there were 46 earthquakes worldwide that had a magnitude of at least 6.5. So it's a fairly major earthquake, and some of them are in more or less inhabited areas. But just last year, and last year was a low seismic, as far as seismic activity goes, yes, last year was a pretty low year. Not a lot of great tragedies, but there were 46 earthquakes around the world that were at least 6.5 magnitude. In Earth's history, there have been at least 10 earthquakes that have accounted for more than 110,000 deaths. Some of them have been fairly recent. You've heard of some of them over, in Haiti, in Indonesia. You've heard of some of the recent earthquakes that were just awful, devastating. But some of these earthquakes took place in ancient history that people recorded. Some of these have been hundreds of years ago. There have always been earthquakes in many places. And some people say, yeah, but it just seems like it's getting more and more. This has got to be something. This has got to be fulfillment of prophecy. And Jesus said that they will get more and more. They'll get more and more frequent. They'll get worse and worse. The greatest earthquake, we just read about the great earthquake during the tribulation period. There's going to be a day where, in fact, look back at Revelation 6. I want to finish reading that chapter and show that there's going to be an earthquake so great. We've never had an earthquake like this. There's going to be an earthquake so great that every man, it says, great or small, whether he's a CEO of a large corporation or whether he's poor, it will make men run and hide in the mountains, wish to die, ask for the mountains to fall on them, because they know that this is Jesus judging the earth and they're scared to death of his wrath. It's interesting. The entire world knows that when this earthquake comes, they know it's the hand of God. It doesn't mean they turn to him. It doesn't mean they repent, but they know it's Jesus. They call it the wrath of the Lamb. Look at verse 12, Revelation 6 and verse 12. "And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places." We just read those. Now the next verse. "And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?" That's quite an earthquake. It brings the greatest, the mightiest men in the world to their knees. They hide out of fear. They wish to die because the wrath of the Lamb is here, and they all agree who is able to stand against this. And so there's going to be great earthquakes. Jesus says at the end of verse 8, Mark 13 and verse 8, he says that these things are the beginnings of sorrows. That expression there, the beginning of sorrows, has to do with birth pangs. In fact, the Greek word for sorrows is the word Odin, and it's translated in the New Testament as pain, sorrow, and travail. He says when you see these things happening, it's going to be the beginnings of birth pangs. It's going to be like a woman going into labor, which I can tell you from firsthand experience, you don't want to be there. But no. It was very peaceful when Melanie gave birth, thanks to the hashtag epidural. But when a birth, here's what happens when birth pangs happen, is that you have a pain, and then it goes away. And then while a little time later, there's another pain, and it's getting a little bit worse than the last one, and then it goes away. And the pains get closer and closer together, and they get worse and worse and worse until something wonderful happens. That's what, there's a great parallel here with the birth pangs, with the end of the age. C.I. Schofield, I think it was, said that what we see here is these birth pangs are the pains of the end of the age and the beginning of the next. And it's going to get worse and worse and worse in our world from every different possible angle. The wars and rumors of wars, the earthquakes, the tragedy, the devastation, the death. It will get worse and worse and worse and worse until it'll be so bad that all of a sudden the greatest thing ever happens and Jesus shows up. And the Messiah is here. So it's interesting that Jesus uses that parallel. One could even say this, that Jesus created the concept of birth pangs to point to this truth, the greatest birth pang in all of history, the tribulation, how it gets worse and worse and worse until all of a sudden Jesus is here, and the end of the world is a very awful thing if somebody doesn't know Jesus. But if somebody knows Jesus, we don't look at all these things that are coming and say, oh no, it's the worst thing ever. Our great salvation is coming. Our blessed hope. Jesus says, look up, for your coming draweth nigh. And the end of the world is awful if you don't know Jesus, but the end of the world is wonderful if you know him. He will usher in the millennial kingdom. He will set up his kingdom of peace. We will then go into the eternal state forever. We will drop sorrow behind. We'll drop pain behind. We'll drop sin, temptation behind. We'll drop having to impress men. All that goes into life that's so difficult. Having to work, the curse of the fall, the curse of childbearing, the sorrow involved, all of that will be dropped when Jesus comes back. And so as Christians, we looked at that verse earlier. I want to just read it one more time as we finish in Titus 2 and verse 11. It says that we should be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. It doesn't mean that God and Jesus will be there. It means that Jesus is God. He's the glorious appearing of our great God, and he is our Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what we look forward to. We'll continue in coming weeks in Mark 13 looking at these other signs and rumors, but we shouldn't focus as much on looking for the signs. We look for the Savior that will send the signs, and we do also want to pity those and be aware of those that will experience his wrath and share the gospel with as many as we can so that they don't, so that they're not having to hide themselves, so that they are not fearful in that day of the Lord's wrath. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this time to be able to study your word. We thank you for the instruction that you give us. You don't leave us in the dark. You didn't leave the disciples in the dark on this day. They asked a specific question, what's the sign of when these things will happen? And you gave very specific details. I pray that you would fill us with the knowledge of these details, and then also help us not to be overcome with fear, help us not to be overcome with dread or anxiety, but help us to know that you are coming back someday. We don't know if it's going to be in our lifetime. It could be very soon, but help us to live our lives like it could be soon. Help us never to look at things that have happened over the last 2,000 years and say, well, it's just going to continue like that. We have no idea how long it could be, and help us to be ready. I pray that everyone in here would know for sure that you are their Savior, that everyone would know that those that are around them, their family members, that they are saved, and help us to be looking for that blessed hope. Help us to be abstaining from sin in this life. Help us to be looking more and more like you and sharing the truth of the gospel and mirroring your goodness to the world so that they can be saved as well. This morning, with heads bowed and eyes closed, just want to kind of take a step back in our lives and ask, are you looking for the blessed hope of Jesus? Do we go through a day, a week, a month, and it never even crosses our mind? Jesus is on the way back. Jesus is coming soon. Am I ready? Do I have my sins confessed? Am I ready to meet Him? Am I ready to spend forever in heaven? It's our blessed hope. As you struggle with the details of life, we have sickness, we have injury, we have disease that we deal with, people that are dying around us. Are we overcome with stress and worry about all these things? Or does the fact that we're looking for the blessed hope, does that carry us? We have joy. Nothing can, you know, no matter how dark something gets, Jesus is coming back, our blessed hope. And we never have to get too down because we're children of God and we have a Savior that's promised He's going to come back and He'll keep that promise. Let's stand to our feet, and as music plays softly, we'll just have a